And this just looks like my family that's going to help me preach this. Everybody here came here to help me preach this, because this is the word of the Lord. Amen. Let's go to 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter. 2 Corinthians 4. And let's look at verses 8 through 18, which are read in our hearing. We will not reread all of these verses, but we would like to emphasize a few of them. So we're going to read 2 Corinthians 4. We'll look at verse number 8 and 9. And then we'll move on to verse number 16, verse number 17, and verse number 18. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's read beginning with verse number 8 and 9. The Bible, the Word of God reads, "We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. For which cause we faint not. But though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things
which are not seen.
For the things enthusiasm, hold on, just a little while longer. Turn to nearby neighbor and say, neighbor, what you been going through?
I said, what?
Amen. I'm straight up in your house. What you been going through? Say, God is able to bring you out. And you may take your seats in the house of God. Somebody say amen. Because all of us been going through something. Amen. 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 We don't all have the same trouble, but all of us know where trouble can be found. Amen. And if we tell the truth about it, sometimes it's found in our house. We all pray to be like tonight. Amen. We just want to be real. Real as the truth of it is. Amen. We want to be real tonight. Just a little while longer. Hold on a little while longer. Look at this text, and here's what you find. In 2 Corinthians, this book is dedicated to the Church of Christ located in Corinth. And Paul is dealing with some situations of life. And what he does is he takes a moment to reflect on his own life. And he conducts a self-evaluation of his ministry, what he's been through, and he takes time to put some things in perspective. You know, in life, we have to do that sometimes. We have to do that. We have to put some things in perspective, because if you focus on the trouble all the time, if you focus on the hardships all of the time, if you focus on the moments of despair all of the times, it can really weigh you down. It can really weigh you down. And I'm learning day by day that this world has lost her mind. Amen. Seems like this world has just lost her mind. And if you have alerts on your cellular device like I do, seems like every hour on the hour, there's some more bad news. There's some more bad news. And for the Christian, we have to be careful not to allow situations to steal our joy. Amen. I mean, if anybody ought to have a reason to sing, it's the Christian. It's the Christian. And Satan wants to not only steal our joy, but he wants to disconnect our blessings. But we have to know, family, that this life is going to be filled with some ups and downs. But how do you hold on when you feel like letting go? I mean, how do you deal with the pressures of life? Well, it would be more convenient, seemingly, sometimes, to just lose a grip and let things go. If you've never been here, then you may not be able to witness on tonight. But I just suspect that you've been alive for a couple weeks. You know what trouble looks like. And trouble has all of our addresses. It has all of our email addresses. It has all of our telephone numbers. Home phone and cellular phone. Amen. The trouble knows how to reach out and touch you. You didn't even call for the trouble, but the trouble called you up. How do you deal with life? I mean, what should be our attitude? Paul looks at this. Paul says, look at it. It's right here in verse number 8. He says, say it with me. We are what? Trouble on every side. You ever been in trouble? I mean, if you wake up in the morning and just seem like trouble. Trouble, trouble, trouble on Monday. Trouble on Monday night. Haven't even gotten over Tuesday. Trouble on Tuesday. Tuesday morning, trouble. Tuesday afternoon, trouble. Tuesday evening, trouble. Wednesday morning, trouble. Just trouble, trouble, trouble. Paul says we are what? Trouble on what? That means at 360 degrees, every side, there's nothing but trouble. And Paul is looking at his ministry, and he says, I want you to know that in this life, there's nothing but trouble. In this life, I'm troubled on every side. Watch what he says as he states his case. He says, I'm troubled. We are troubled on every side. Yet, not distressed. Here it is. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Here it is. We are persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Paul uses a term in verse number 8, pressed. Verse number 8, he says we've been pressed. The Bible is saying that like grapes are pressed so that the juice might flow. Oh Lord, help me preach this sermon. Trouble will press you. Press you like the wine press. Presses the grapes. They tell me in ancient time that they would lay the grapes out on the pressing floor and that they would actually physically get in, amen, sacks and then began to apply the weight of the body on top of the grape. Now, if you ask that grape, how did it feel? That grape would probably have to testify that it didn't feel too good. It didn't feel good when they were under the weight of the individual who was pressing the juice out. That didn't feel good. But if you ask the person who took a sip, y'all don't help me out here. If you ask the person who took a sip of the juice that came from the grapes didn't feel good in that position. But it sure tasted good once the juice started flowing. Oh, may I submit to somebody in here that every now and then life will press you. Life will press. It seems all of the juice out, but God knows whatever's inside of you, when he presses you, whatever's inside has to come on out. If you feel with joy, it's only when God presses you that he can bring joy out. If you feel with praise, the only way he can bring your praise out is he has to press you. But I like what Paul says. Paul says, Yet we're not in despair. Now watch it. Pressing a trouble means that's something that happens exterior. He said, but we're not in despair, that's interior. He said, I'm trouble on the side, I'm trouble on the left, I'm trouble on the right, I'm trouble in front, I'm trouble behind, but it has not gotten in on the inside. He said, I know I got trouble, I have trouble all around, but I'm not in despair. You all see this? If you wake up one day, it's your back. You wake up the next day, it's your leg. Y'all know what I'm doing. They tell me that after a while, and I can say this, y'all, because I've heard some of my members doing some funny things these days. Running up the steps the other day, trying to, just doing what I do. And I've always run up the steps. Somebody say, you run up the steps. I always run up the steps. I've always been young. But my knees told me. Y'all don't help me now, do I? Amen. Kobe Bryant just retired recently. Amen. We in the same age bracket. Amen. I know why he had to get off that hard with you. Because there comes a point in time where you have to transition out of one position into another. Get up in the morning, sounding like a bowl of cereal. Snap. Y'all been helping me over here. Trouble on every side. Yet, we're not in despair. In other words, Paul says, we've been knocked down, but we're not knocked down. Am I right about it? Paul would say, we've been squished, but have been squashed. Am I right about it? Paul would say, we've been cast out, but we're not out for the count. Am I right about it? Paul would say, we've been pushed aside, but we have not been pushed away. Am I right about it? Paul saw the positive in every negative. And that's what we have to do, Christians. Family, we have to see the positive in every negative. I'm going through some pain. I'm going through some trials. I'm being persecuted. But there is a positive in every negative. If you're going to get your battery to fire up like it should, you have to have a positive charge. Y'all gonna help me. And a negative charge. And without the positive and the negative, you don't move very far. Am I right about it? For every negative, we have to see the what? Now drop down to verse number 16. Let's hurry up and get everybody home, my brothers. The Bible says what? For which cause we faint not, read on.
But though our outward man perish.
He said, but though our outward man perish.
Yet the inward man is renewed.
Yet the inward man is renewed.
Day by day.
Now watch it now. He says, though our outward man perish, the inward man is renewed day by day. Now, I know that when we consider life, many times we think about ourselves as a body having a soul. But I want to suggest to somebody on tonight that we need to flip it. We need to redirect our focus. We're not a body that has a soul, but we're really a soul that has a body. Am I right about it? And you have to look at life that way. You see, we were already who we are prior to having a body. It's not body and then I have a soul to carry around. It's a soul. Then God clothes me with a body. Someone said, thank you, prove it, preacher. Get for me. Jeremiah chapter 1 and verse number 5. Jeremiah chapter 1 and verse number 5. I just want you to see that we are a soul and then we have a body. We're not a body first, we're a soul first. Well, let me prove it. The Bible says what for the weapons?
Before I formed thee in the belly.
God said to Jeremiah, before I formed you in the belly, read on.
I knew you.
Read on.
And before
you came from the womb, read on.
I sanctified you
and I ordained you to be a prophet unto the nations. Oh, Lord, break it down one more time. Bible says,
before I formed thee in the belly.
Before I formed you, that's physical.
Yeah.
Am I right about it? God said, before I formed you in the belly, I know what happens in the procreation, reproduction process. But before you ever entered into your mother's womb, before you came out, I'd already sanctified you, set you apart. I had a plan for your life. I submit to you, family, that if God would have a plan for Jeremiah, and if God could set apart Jeremiah, and if God could know Jeremiah, is powerful enough to have known all of us before we ever got here. Am I right about it? I said, he already had a plan for you. He already had a mission for you. He already knew what family you'd be born into. He knew. And so when I look at life, Brother Thompson, I have to admit that I'm not a body with a soul. I'm a soul with a body. Now watch it. When you see life that way, it shapes your understanding.
Yeah.
It shapes your understanding. Because you see that it's not about the carnal, but rather the eternal. Now let me prove that in the message of the Lord. Go back to 2 Corinthians 4.
Yes, sir.
Look at verse number. Number 17. Listen to this.
For our light affliction.
Paul said, for our light affliction.
Which is but for a moment. Working for us a far more exceeding and eternal greater glory.
Now we're going through some things right now. But the things that we're going through have a purpose. Light affliction. I'm going through some things. Paul said, what we go through is light. It serves a purpose for something that comes ahead. And the only way I'm going to accept that, I can't think carnally. I have to think spiritually. See, that person that didn't speak to you. They didn't speak to you because something happened. But if you think carnally, you're not going to speak best to God. Because that's all you're looking at. That's all you see. But when you understand that the trying of your faith works with patience, and then when you understand this truth shall pass, and then you understand that you are not to fret yourself over evildoers, neither be thou envious of the workers of iniquity. And when you understand that the Lord prepares a table before you in the presence of your enemies, this means that what God has planned for you, the folk who can't stand you, they don't like to see you eat, but they can't stop you. They can't get to you. And they have to sit the devil. elevate his thinking. He said, this is light affliction. What we're going through right now, this is light. But it has a purpose. See, I don't understand everything that happens in my life, Brother Wells. But whatever happens, Brother Wells, we have to know it has a purpose. It has a purpose. Read the next verse. The Bible says what?
While we look not at the things which are seen.
And this is how Paul would say that. We're not looking. He said what?
While we look not at the things which are seen.
We're not looking at the things which are seen. Read.
But at the things which are not seen.
He said, but we'll focus on what we don't see.
All right.
Wait a minute. Paul, how are you focused on something you can't see?
Oh.
How can you trust in something that you don't see?
Yeah.
Hold your hand. Hebrews 11 says, now faith, I need somebody to help me preach this. It's the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of what you cannot see. Oh, so Paul was walking by faith. Must have been walking by faith because he called some things that he didn't see as though he did see. Am I right about it? I don't see how I'm going to make it past this terrible situation in my life, but I have to walk by faith and not by sight. And the God of all strength will give me what I need to get all of the hurt, to get all of the pain. Yes, I remember the pain, but I'm not going to allow the pain to keep me confined and to keep me in prison, to keep me from serving Almighty God.
Amen.
So I have to focus on the eternal thing.
For the things which are seen are temporal.
Things that are seen. If you can see it,
well,
you better get used to not seeing it.
All right.
That doesn't make any sense, does it? But it makes all the sense in the world. If you can hold it, you better learn to live with a loose grip on it. Because if you can see it, it can be taken from you. Am I right about it?
Yeah.
Enjoy the accoutrement of life, but don't be attached to it. Am I right about that? Yeah. Enjoy that nice vehicle, but just realize that one day you're going to have to turn it loose. Am I right about that? Enjoy that nice position on the job, but just realize one day you're going to have to turn it loose. Enjoy that nice house, but just realize that one day you're going to have to let it go. Paul says that anything we see is temporary.
The things which you see are temporary.
Keep reading.
But the things which are not seen.
The things that are not seen are eternal. Read on.
For
we know that if our earthly house is
dissolved,
keep reading.
We have a building of God.
We have a building of God. Now watch it. He said, now I want you to know that all these things which are tangible leave us, we still have another building. I mean, if my house, God forbid, burns down, I still have another building. Because my house cannot burn down my home. And I'm right about it. Because it's not about what I have on the outside. It's about what I have on the inside. God forbid something happened to this edifice. But even if this edifice is no longer here, we still are the South Union Church of Christ. I'm right about it. Because we are not holding on so tightly to the things that we see. Because we realize the things that we see one day, we'll have to leave them behind. When we come to that understanding, we have to know to hold on a little while longer. I remember, I'm getting ready to close, but I remember that when I was growing up, my mother would sing a song, and it would go, she would say that I've heard the thunder, I've seen the lightning flashing, and I've heard the thunder roll, I felt sin greater action, trying to conquer my soul. Then I heard the voice of Jesus telling me still to fight on. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. I can remember that old hymnologist who said, through many dangers, I wish I had somebody with me. Toils and snares, I've already come. It was grace that taught my heart to sing, and it's grace that will lead me home. I wish I had somebody who been in the church long enough to say, and God So here's what we have to do. We're not supposed to. I heard that from Booker. And we're not supposed to.
Amen.
Because if we could see everything God can see, we have no need for God.
That's right. That's right.
But I'm going to tell you something. This is why we can hold on a little while longer. Whatever you're going through, whatever it is, you can make it. God's going to bring you out. And you have to reassure yourself that God can bring us out. Even when you don't see the way out. Because it's not about what you see. It's about what God sees. Turn to your neighbor right now and say, neighbor, hold on.
Hold on.
Just shake somebody's hand in the house of God. Just shake somebody's hand. Tell them you're going to make it out. Y'all deserve it. Thank you, Jesus. Come to Jesus right now. Every day may not be a sunny day per se, but it's a day that God can bring you through.
Yes.
What we have to do is learn to hold on just a little while. And that's easier said than done. Amen, somebody. Yeah, that's easy to say, you know. It is. It's easy to say it. Sometimes it's difficult to do. But you're a child of God. And because you're a child of God, God's going to bring you out. He's going to bring you out. Amen.
Amen.
And that's how we know he's going to bring us out. Because he already has. That's exactly right. So he can bring you out of this situation. Trust him. Hold on. God's unchanging.
Yes.
Say yes to Jesus right now. Put him on in baptism for the remission of your sins. Confess the sweetest name in the mortal tongue. Understand that Jesus died for our sins, that we might live forever and be a redeemed people unto his Father. Understand that Jesus still lives and he's coming back. And when he comes back, we want him to see us holding on. Holding on just a little while longer. If you're already part of the body of Christ, if you need prayer, you need to repent of sin, do it right now. Whatever you do, do not leave here without being on the other side. Will you come as we sing the song of invitation?
Trouble in my way.
Oh,